My talk today will be about looking at the world as we see it today from the eyes of a computer scientist, but also from the view of people and customers of all the computing technology in the world. And then I will relate to the many years of computing research that I have done and how they are providing building blocks to this to solutions that we need in today's world to take computing to the next few years. So just very briefly reflecting on my own sort of research pathway that has taken me to where we are now, and some of this was hinted at already in the introductions. I have always been inspired by the application of research results and by applications that are driving the research questions. So I've always been relatively close to looking at what the world out there needs and how the research that that I'm working on works in this. It started with my undergraduate project where I was working with Praxis Critical Systems on a little validation problem. And through my PhD and postdocs, I always was on projects with heavy company involvement where the problems that we were addressing were really driven by needs of the industry, but needs that needed new and novel research and innovations to take place. Once I finished my PhD, I moved into web services research, an area that was just coming up at that time, but that very naturally followed on from the ideas that I looked at in my PhD, where I was looking at systems that are changing dynamically at runtime. And we will see more of that throughout today's lecture. In the more recent future, we have seen a lot of changes in the computing infrastructures. We are talking about cloud, Internet of Things, fog, and edge computing. And all of these are enabling architectures that deliver and enable us to build the systems that we are all using today, whether we are actually aware of using them or not. And we will see some of that as well in the presentation. I have also always been on that boundary between applied research, working with companies, looking at where research fits into this, and obviously the very academic areas, some of those much more pragmatic, some of those on the very formal end of computer science. And that, I guess, has taken me to where I am today. And in the lecture, we will see many of these aspects. So today's session, I want to structure in a way that I want to give some motivation for why we're doing the computer science we are doing today. I will look at the key issues that I think we have that are holding us back, but also issues that are enabling us to move into this new phase of where the world has gotten to. I will look at the puzzle pieces that we need for and in terms of technologies and ideas and research that we need to put together, and then focusing obviously on the aspects that I have made contributions to over many years, and wrapping up towards the end of the session before we have questions. So if we look at the world today, over the last year and a half, we have seen a huge rise and awareness as well of data science happening. Unfortunately, the reason was, of course, the pandemic, but that has brought data science very much towards the forefront for many, many people. But data science hasn't started there, and the data science we have seen there isn't all that that we need to consider and look at. So over many years, research in computing has looked at solutions to smart cities, smart cars, many other areas prefixed with the label smart. So if we just pick out a few examples and then we look at some of those in more detail later on. If you look at smart cities, for example, today we can drive around cities that are more and more being populated with what we call smart homes or smart buildings. They're buildings that manage their energy supply. So if the sun is shining on one side of the building, then that heat can be distributed around the building to the shady side of the building automatically, with the building as infrastructure making decisions on distributing that heat to ensure that energy is saved. I'm sure we've all read about autonomous vehicles in the press. They have been in the news for many, many years. Sadly, quite often they occur in the news when bad things happen, such as a car driving into a standing vehicle. But again, it is the technologies, it's the computing and the data processing behind the scenes that's enabling these developments. And ultimately, they will lead to very, very positive developments. So for example, there have been trials with lorries driving very close behind each other in large fleets with distances of just a meter between the vehicles on motorways at motorway speed, enabled by these autonomous vehicle technologies, which in turn then leads to the lorries that are not leading the train, saving up to 30 to 40% of their petrol, which is great for the environment. So that's the sort of advantages that we are looking at. All of these technologies are meant to make life on this planet more sustainable and better for people. Other areas are smart agriculture. Over many decades, we've heard stories about fertilizer being used in too great amounts on fields and then entering our drink water courses. And nowadays, smart agriculture measures the ground conditions. It looks at the crop growth on fields and uses that information in near real time to dictate where we are fertilizing fields. And there are other areas such as smart medicine or smart finance. And if we do search around, then they feed in everywhere. But generally what we find is that the computing technologies we have are nowadays empowering systems in which we are sensing information to then analyze that data, to work with the data we are gathering, to influence how we are then acting. And it's that piece of work that we are very interested here. And what we find in that context is data. We find data everywhere. And if you look at the press, it's very interesting because it's usually not the computing press that is picking up on the big stories. So a few years ago, The Economist reported, for example, that data is now the commodity in the world. It's the most valuable resource we have. It's worth more than oil in terms of the economy. And we can see that this data, often referred to as big data, has grown very, very rapidly in the last few years. So another quite surprising fact, at least it's a fact that I always find very surprising, is that that over the last few years, whenever one looks at numbers, it's around, the statement is that 90% of the data we have, the total data and information we have at our disposal, was collected in the last few years. And that has been rolling in this way over the last 5 to 6 years. So whenever we look again, we have collected that much more data that we still have collected 90% in the last few years. Very nice exponential behavior here. But also a very, very scary behavior. So if we think back for how many millennia humanity has collected data, then it is very, very worrying that we are collecting data at this rate of growth. Because in the end, we have to do things with data. And what we have to do is we have to process it. We have to make sense of that data. And typical data processing cycles are collecting the data, processing the data, so making some sense of it, possibly storing some of that data, and acting on the data. Because just knowing that we've done a lot doesn't help. So if we look at a very obvious example, many of us have a kind of step counter, Fitbit or use our phones or Apple Watches or whatever device we have to count the steps we do in a day. That's great. The phone will store that information for us and we know we have done 5,000 or 15,000 steps. But if that's all we have and we don't do anything from it, then what does that data do for us? Because in the end, what we want is we want to act on this data. We want to know that if we do more steps, it will be healthier for us. But what does more mean for us? And it's these decisions that I think the systems we are developing need to address. Other chains in data processing, and that's one that's been relatively common with some of the big kind of cloud companies such as Google and Amazon and so on, and one that reflects the value in data is a sort of collect and store approach. So many of these big players are just trying to collect as much data as they can and then store it. Because they know, or they think they know, that at some point in the future, there's a lot of value in that data for them, but they haven't yet managed to access it. For me, another very interesting approach to data processing is the collect, process, act kind of cycle. So we collect some data, we get some insights, we process it, we understand what it means, and we act. And this is, I think, is a cycle we see in many of the kind of current scenarios that are emerging. Smart car driving down the motorway, sensing that there is an obstacle ahead, processing, identifying that that obstacle needs to be addressed by slowing the car down, changing the lane and bypassing it. And we do that, we have collected the data, we've processed it, we acted, and we move on. Nothing happened, everything is fine, exactly in the same way that the human driver would operate the car. So there's no need to store that data. But maybe we sometimes do want to store, and again, we can look at different cycles there. But we have in this data processing varying components that we do need to look at, from collecting the data to acting on the insights we can gain from it. So out of that, we can look at the news, and the news is coming in daily. Sometimes it comes in as bad news, sometimes it comes in as good news. So if we look at a lot of AI applications in medicine, then quite often they are very reliable in identifying, for example, cancers from images that we're seeing. If we're looking at automated facilities in warehousing and transport, then again we see a lot of very positive developments. And now in some cities, for example, in Milton Keynes, you have little delivery robots driving around around the streets doing deliveries to houses. But quite often what we read in the news is about data breaches, it's about automated cars getting into accidents, and all of those problems. We also find that the data that we're gathering comes in many, many different forms. So we sort of, for data analytics problems, often talk about multimodal solutions, where we are looking at data that's in different shapes. And the data that has been growing most rapidly in the last decade is data that we gather from sensors, so generally what we call the Internet of Things. So this is data which personally I wouldn't call big data. To me, it's a sort of lots of little data. It's temperature readings, it's position readings, it's very small items of data, but items that we are collecting incredibly rapidly, maybe in second intervals, maybe in millisecond intervals, and that we're transporting to the cloud to store. The other major growth in data has been in social media. So if we think back even 10 years, then many social media channels were just emerging. They were something that people were obviously starting to become aware of. But if you look through the last US presidency, for example, the activity on Twitter in political circles has hugely stepped up. And that sort of reflects the general behavior of the population in these messages that are being picked up. And again, it is, in some sense, lots of little data that's adding up into this big data scenario, because Twitter messages aren't that long, but there are millions and millions of them every day. When we think about that, then I think we have to really quite seriously take a step back and think about what are the issues that we are causing in this world, and what do we need to do to really make the most of those potential data feeds and applications that we have. And one question there is very much around transporting data. Because in the end, if you're collecting data from a sensor and we're shipping it to some cloud server, we are using the bandwidth on our 3G, 4G wired internet services, and we're swamping them with data, especially if we're sending data at very rapid intervals, often in rural, more rural areas where connection speeds might be slower. And we're overlaying that onto the normal use of the internet with people downloading videos, doing email and doing their daily work. Then with the growth that we see, we will reach a natural limit of how much data we can transport. So we need radical solutions to that. It's making sense of that data. Yes, we are amazing at collecting this data. We're pretty good at storing it, but can we process it at the pace that we need to? And to me, there's two ways of processing data. One is collect it and then analyze it and retrospectively start to make sense of it. And there's value in that in terms of policy making. So if we know, for example, that a road is always overcrowded, then we do know that that we need to maybe build another lane on that road. But that's a very, very slow solution. I think for many applications that are exciting and interesting, we need to do things differently. We need to process data very fast. We want quick insights into the data. And many medical applications, many transport applications are of that nature. When you're driving into a town, you don't want to know that there was that there's going to be a traffic jam. What you want to know is that as you're approaching it, that you're sent a different route, because that will get you to your destination quicker. And crucially, that making sense of data has to be correct. So we have to really make good decisions on the data that we're making. If we're making the wrong decisions, then the consequences can be quite catastrophic. We also need to think about storing data. So if we look at some other statistics, then today some data centers, those are the big data warehouses that the cloud providers use, are using a disproportionate amount of the energy we are producing. Depending on which statistics one looks at, it's on par, above or just behind the airline and global shipping industry. That's a vast amount of energy used that all leads to more CO2 in the atmosphere, and we all know that that's not very good for our climate. But as we're storing more data, we need more such capacity. So we do need to start to think about what do we do about this data? Do we really need to store it? And that's a very, very difficult question to answer, because if we don't store it and we realize 2 years later that we need it, or even 2 days later, then we've lost an opportunity. If we do store it and we never need it, then we have wasted energy. So this is a question we really need to explore, and it might be very application specific. But we also need to think about the structure of the data we store. And traditional enterprise data is often stored in, for example, bank records, transaction records in banks, your internet shopping kind of invoices and so on are structured into SQL databases in a very standard way. They're very efficient for standard kind of searches, but we often want to find more interesting insights into our data. And we will see some of that structure aspects later in the talk. And the final two aspects are around quality of data. So how do we know that the data we have is good? And how do we audit and provide that evidence trail on the decisions we have been making? And finally, privacy. I think certainly in the Western world, we are very concerned about data being leaked, about privacy being invaded. And I think we do need to think about that. So if we take all of those kind of challenges that we have in the world, and we move that into the kind of concepts and ideas we have in the computing community that are close to my research, but in general that exist in the community, then we do have a number of key concepts that that will make their appearance throughout the rest of this presentation. One of those is cloud computing, and that's the idea that we have computing infrastructure that's owned by someone, but that we can tap into for our processing, for storage, and that enables us to kind of flexibly scale up. So if we need to store more data for a month, we can do it. We don't have to buy anything new, we just rent more space for it. And then as our demand shrinks, we can return that space and stop paying for it. Typically, these are resourced through data centers, and many of the data centers are hosted by some of the big computing providers that we know in the world. And these data centers provide both the sort of hardware and the software stack. So they do provide the hardware on which we can store data, so the disks and the compute power and the networking to move the data in and out. But they also provide software that we can use for either directly for processing the data, or on top of which we can build that processing power. And cloud computing really has enabled this concept of big data. More recently, we've seen a move away from the central cloud, building on the realization that a lot of the capacity and facilities we have in our kind of small devices are actually very powerful. So we don't need to move everything to the cloud. We can do some of that processing in the edge or in the fog. So for example, on a mobile phone or on an end user device or somewhere in the network on the way to the cloud. And that's one of the areas that I have been very, very interested in for many years is sort of shifting processing to the right place in the network. And we will see more of that in a moment. We also have service computing, and service computing has enabled a new way of building software systems. Essentially, we're looking at services that can be composed and put together in a just-in-time fashion. So they can be put together at runtime of the system to create the sort of functionality we want. And often that is driven through business processes or scientific workflows where sort of an overarching structure exists, where each task in that process is then fulfilled by a service that's acting on our data. And the great thing about bringing sort of the cloud, edge, and fog computing ideas and the serving computing ideas together is that services are so self-contained that they can relatively easily be moved from one system to another and can process data and can work on that data in exactly the right place where they're most efficient. The other things that have happened is obviously the Internet of Things or cyber-physical systems, where we are trying to integrate entities in the real world into those computer networks. And that's usually done through electronic components called sensors and actuators. Sensors allow us to gather information from the environment, convert it into a digital format, which can then be used to inform and to be processed. And then any decisions we have can be pushed out to actuators. And examples there, for example, in a intelligent home or in a smart home, could be that that if the burglar alarm is sensing a movement in the house, then all the doors get locked automatically. So the automatic door locks would be the actuators. The thing with Internet of Things is we are scaling these ideas not to a single house or to a single entity, but we are scaling them to a kind of global scale. And we are in a world where we already have billions of sensors, and the number of sensors is growing incredibly rapidly every year. And they're existing in all sorts of devices. So I think probably a modern mobile phone will have 20, 30, 40 sensors in it, sensing anything from the movement to your GPS position, to its temperature, to the charging status of the battery. And that's just an average kind of standard customer device. And finally, we have the sort of technologies that make sense of the data, that get new insights into the data, and that allow us to really work with that data. And they are artificial intelligence and machine learning. Those ideas are making appearances quite regularly as well in sort of common terminology these days. And I personally have an interest in what I might call semantically enhanced data. So data where we're not just looking at the value of that data, but where we are looking at the links of that data to other data items. And we will see an example of that later, where we applied this in a very practical financial context. In terms of big data, I think the key ideas to take away from here is big data is about a lot of data. And that data is typically very varied. So it can range from images to simple temperature readings. It can be driven at volume. So many of these data items are collected very rapidly, very often. So there are huge amounts of them. The more complex data is maybe collected less often, but it's just so big based on its value, for example, the human genome or other data like that. And the interesting applications that we see, all of the kind of smart world applications that I was speaking about earlier and will continue to talk about, are all about the need to combine the various data items to make the most of the opportunity. And at this point, I do like to kind of take a step a few years back and reflect on something that I did in my PhD. So in my PhD, I looked at a problem called feature interactions in telephone systems. And then in my postdoc, I looked at this as the concept of policy conflict. And the idea is relatively simple. You have a telephone system that's working perfectly fine. You're adding new functionality to it called features. And typical features in those days were call waiting, where you would get a notification if another call is coming in while you're busy, or the feature of call forwarding, which would redirect the call when you're busy to another number. Now, the basic system exists. Each feature in its is programmed and written and tested in isolation, and they work. So there's nothing wrong with what's being programmed. But then at runtime, when the telephone system is up and running and a user has made some decisions which features they have on their telephone line, we can suddenly find problems occurring. And the problem with call waiting and call forwarding is essentially call comes in, you're busy. Should you hear the call waiting tone or should the call be forwarded to another person? And the system does need to make a decision on this. Now, typically, approaches to resolve these issues were what we would call design time approaches. So you would try to test the system, you would try to test all the combinations of features on the system, and you would then make a decision that these two things cannot be possibly used together. So you do need to arbitrate and you need to build in a solution into the system. In my work, we started to look at what I would call runtime approaches. Some people would talk about online approaches, where we would say, well, fine, let's have these things on the system. Let's monitor for that emerging behavior and then start to manage it. So if the call comes in, then let's make a runtime decision on that phone where that problem occurs. And that is useful because if you wanted to try to test or check all possible combinations of all possible features, you're spending a vast amount of time on checking things that in reality probably never encounter each other in any real system, because it's different users using different features. And as long as they don't make a phone call to each other, their features have no opportunity to conflict. So it makes sense to deal with this emerging behavior at runtime. And I think that's nowadays reflecting in many of the systems, such as self-driving vehicles, where again, you can't possibly program or pre-plan for all eventualities that can happen on the road. I think every driver will know this. There will always be situations where you do need to make a decision in the moment. There will be new scenarios you are entering. You couldn't plan for them, but you manage and you make a decision on that behavior as and when you encounter it. Now, probably the right approach is to combine these a little bit and use as much design time approaches to keep things as safe as we can, but then manage and support the runtime decisions for these emerging behaviors using that insight that we have from the design time. Now that's obviously quite some time back when I looked at these feature interaction problems, but looking at them in current scenarios, they do reoccur, and it's in services and workflows I have seen them, where we are looking at again a dynamic system where components are being brought together as that system is executing. And now in the kind of data processing and analytics world, we see this even more. So I already hinted at traffic routing earlier, and it is about a decision between policy making. So trying to understand the problem, trying to understand what is or isn't working in our cities, and then replanning and restructuring the street network in them. That's a very long-term sort of plan and approach that obviously our city councils and so on are engaged with, versus the sort of runtime solution of putting the data that we see in the now. So if we nowadays look at some of the routing apps we have on our phones, they will tell us about traffic jams ahead of us, and they will tell us of different routes. Now, at the moment, that's quite selfish because they only look at the picture as it is, and they tell us individually how we should be changing our routes. But if you start to take this into a more kind of bigger picture approach where different cars can start to exchange information and plan together on how they are overcoming these problems, then we are looking at a very different scenario. And the sort of architectures that we are developing support those reacting in the now kind of decisions. A related scenario, but different in some sense, is in the area of precision medicine, where we might talk about medical solutions. So if for example, you have a patient who's at risk of heart attack or diabetic shock, then their mobile phone could monitor their behavior as they carry it throughout the day. And it can, for that individual, make decisions. So if it notices that the individual needs to move more now to avoid, a heart attack in half an hour, then it can give the user that advice. The user starts moving, risk goes down, everything is good. Or the device notices that the user doesn't move, and then might kind of preemptively call an ambulance so that they are in place when needed. But the problem we have there is that we do need to combine individual data. So we need to look at the individual and their kind of situation and combine that with sort of demographic understanding that we have around that group of people or around a certain illness and how that behaves. And in precision medicine, we need to bring these together. But again, I think we need to bring these insights together, not in terms of the sort of policy making in terms of what tablets we might prescribe, but really into the now, where we are looking at giving immediate advice. And I guess if you look at the track and trace apps that we have at the moment due to COVID, then they are a bit of that demographic solution. So they are looking at tracking and tracing behavior, and then retrospectively telling people that they were exposed to a certain risk. It would be much greater if we could tell people immediately as they are out and about that they are entering a zone where the risk for them is higher, and that warns them off from going further. And we can find them other examples there. The third kind of example I do want to look at is an example of processing the data on the edge versus in the cloud. So if we look, for example, at smart car insurances at the moment, they are car insurances where you have a tracking device in the car that is reporting back to the insurance company on the weather condition, on the driving conditions, on road conditions, on your driving speed, and on all sorts of behaviors that you have. Are you braking and accelerating very rapidly? So are you driving quite aggressively or not? And it's reporting all of this data to the insurance company. So you could look back at that privacy issue that I mentioned earlier, because that is quite privacy invading. And the insurance company then adjusts the rate to be paid on the policy. Now that's processing the collecting the data and processing it in the cloud. But I think what we also might be able to do is to process that data in the car, because the only thing the insurance company really needs to know is whether the risk of your driving has gone up or down in a given time. So if the car reports risk is increasing or risk is decreasing, then that's sufficient for the insurance company. And in some sense, they don't need to know why this is increasing. Maybe it is because you're driving aggressively. Maybe it is because you just hit a spot of really bad weather on the road. But those details could stay with you in the car, and I think our privacy would be much better. So if we then take these ideas and put them into what I term data processing architectures, then we're starting to kind of get a picture of what's going on. So in these architectures, we have sort of a zone of sensing and acting, which is our interface with the real world, with machines, equipment, sensors, gathering data and providing insight on the world around us, but also devices that can change things. So for example, in the agricultural thing, the sensor could be taking pictures of the ground and analyze them to understand certain fertilizer concentration, and then could drive a machine to release more or less fertilizer as the actuator. Now that data from the sensors is gathered, it needs processing, filtering, forwarding, and that's sort of the edge and cloud zone, fog zone, where we are looking at applying some of the more simpler techniques. And the shortest loop that I mentioned earlier would be sensing, processing, acting. And there are many of the applications that are of huge interest today that need this cycle. Whereas many applications that are written today from a computing sense are looking at a much longer cycle. They are looking at a sensing, forwarding to the cloud, storing, then applying some AI, and then maybe eventually going back out to some act or processing results in the real world. But we can take any sort of loop through this. And what we find is that if we look at the areas here, we see many of our technologies that we've spoken about earlier emerge. So we see services in IoT. They can be deployed to these devices at the edge. They can look at really interacting with this real world. And the services gives us that potential to move program functionality right to the sensor. And we have done this in applications for fast data processing, where we have pushed some of that decision making right to the edge. Once we start to get more into the middle, we might look at doing some AI, so the orange puzzle type, some AI and software services on our edge devices, on our fog devices, and actually get insights. Maybe not the perfect insights with all the data that we could possibly have, but insights built around the data we gathered recently or gathered just now, and act on it very, very fast. Otherwise, we go into the cloud, and then obviously we can do other things there. But we do need to understand that the further away from the sensor we go, or the longer that processing chain is, the longer the time delay is between sensing something and sending a result, and also the higher the cost in terms of bandwidth and storage and gathering and managing that data becomes, bringing us back to some of the questions we've mentioned earlier. And the focus of my work, and that's where we will see much more now in the next few slides, has been in this sort of central zone around services for taking the data from the end devices and working with them, doing things in the cloud in terms of workflows and processes and running things in the cloud. But always with this view that the systems I'm looking at are interacting with sensing or acting capability, or are interacting with AI techniques at the cloud level. So in that sense, if I would just reflect then on some of the questions that I have been addressing, and that are really relevant for all of the scenarios we're looking at. One of those is around selecting the right data and the right place to process. So how do we know which data we need to process, and where are we doing that processing? And that answers to that question address our bandwidth usage, the speed of processing, data storage, and also privacy as concepts. And there we've done work around autonomous objects, where we are giving a lot of power to the edge device to almost operate independently or interacting with peer devices by need. We're looking at hybrid solutions where we are deciding that some processing can take place at the edge or on that end device, but some does need to be shipped to the cloud. And we have been looking at structured processes, for example, scientific workflows that tend to process genomic data sets, for example, looking for drug candidates and eliminating those that are not hopeful, so they don't even make it to lab trials. And I think big successes of those sorts of technologies we've seen in the rapid pace at which the COVID medications were produced. So those vaccines could be produced so quickly because a lot of data processing can be applied to candidate drugs and eliminate them before even any lab trial needs to be undertaken. But we also need to look at how we can filter the data. So we need to think about what data can we start to throw away at the point of collection because it's not giving us any new insights. And I hope I will have some convincing examples of that in a moment as well. And then it's obviously a question around what software, what service do we use to process the data? And there again, we are looking at selection questions. So we are looking at flexibility in workflows, understanding how we select the right services for a given problem. But we're also looking at maybe automated approaches for planning complex services and breaking those down more automatically, again, at runtime. So if I take a few minutes to look at service selection, then in service selection, we are looking at that idea of picking the right software service for working with a set of data. And that can be either selecting a single service. So if we have a simple task to do, we are looking at selecting a simple single service. If we do have a complex task, then often we have a workflow or automatically planned workflow that chains a number of tasks together to drive a solution. And in that area, we then want to select the service for the whole workflow so that every task is obviously executed by a relevant service. And in that space, we then need to look at two decisions. So for every service, we have a question on functionality and what we call non-functional properties. So clearly the service needs to do what we want it to. If we think about a transport service that's taking us from our home to the nearest train station, then the functionality is quite clear. It's a transport service. It takes you from one place to another. But we then also have what we call non-functional properties, and they are around the sort of quality of that service. And the quality might be of a transport service might be around cost, how expensive it is. It might be around the comfort we have. For example, a taxi is probably much more comfortable because it picks you up at your door and drops you off where you need to go, whereas a bus, well, you probably have to walk to a bus stop and wait and hope for one to come along. And as I said already, it's then also, and that's more relevant for software service, it's about the best place for executing a service. And that's driven by how much data do we need to ship around? Can we move the service to a different place? Do we best distribute the service to many devices and have lots of instances running at the edge? or is it better for that service to run in a central place where all applications use it? So in Context EU project, that's one of the projects that that José referred to early on, we were looking at selecting services for team working, but they were meant to be selected to be most appropriate for the users. And in some sense, the architecture looked at gathering the context information, so our sensing piece, and then we built the kind of criteria and rule-based selection mechanism, which had two phases, a filtering phase and a ranking phase. And in the filtering phase, we're essentially sorting out all of the services that are just not right for what we need. And then in the ranking phase, we're ordering the services by a sort of preference scoring algorithm. So an algorithm that tells us which service is best for what we need. And those methods are fantastic for selecting a single service. So if we need to pick a service, then let's throw all of the service candidates that are not relevant away, and let's rank the remaining ones. So if you want to pick an example, you want to go to dinner in a restaurant, then all the restaurants that don't offer dinner, you can immediately filter out in your vicinity because they are not relevant to you. And then the ranking, you might look at the star rating or the hygiene rating of the restaurant, or a combination of factors, maybe ranging from price and hygiene and so on, to then understand which one might be best suited for your needs. And then the algorithm here would suggest the best one for you to go to. If we put this into a slightly larger context of selecting services as part of a workflow, so our workflow here is sort of just three abstract tasks that need to be done to get us from our starting place to the end. And we, for each of the tasks, we have a number of services that we can choose. And for simplicity, we only look at the cost of the service here. So if we would need to select a service for task one, obviously we would pick this one because it's the cheapest. Great. So let's move on, pick it. But then as we come to the next service, we encounter something that's maybe a little unusual. And that's where our kind of planning and forward thinking just need to come in some way. Because here we see that the cost for the next service is dependent on the choice we made earlier. And we can see that actually this service, together with the one we've chosen, will bring us to, in this case, £7. Whereas had we chosen this service, then maybe we would have had other options here. And we do, because this service together with this one would only cost us £6. So in some sense, we are seeing a kind of a deal here, where one service says, if you use me together with something else, you're getting a discount. And we have all encountered this at times when we were still allowed to travel quite freely. Car rental or hotels might be cheaper in conjunction with an airline ticket from a certain airline. So if you fly with British Airways, maybe with Avis car rental, you only pay half the price. So the decision for chaining services together and choosing them depends on connections between those services. Now you could say, well, that's fine. So let's just plan the whole thing ahead. We know we have three tasks. Let's think about all of the service candidates. Let's run all of them and let's move on. But what we then find is that if we are in a dynamic world where services become available and unavailable, that no longer works, it no longer holds. So we need to work around this. And I'll just quickly skip through the rest of this. And in that sense, if we look at those compositions of services, we are looking at combinations of services that achieve a task, and we're looking at the workflows. But again, we see that workflows can be a very dynamic thing that are changing at runtime. And at some end, we would like the services to be changed. The workflow might change based on some rule that we are applying. So rather than being re-engineered, we want dynamic changes at runtime that then are embedded through to the services we select to run them. if we return our attention back to the data processing, we looked at the no latency data processing. So we do want to look at bandwidth reduction and fast replies. And if we look at the scenario there, we can look at the scenario of taxis. So for example, if we have users waiting for taxis, then they want taxis that are in their vicinity or that get to them quickly and that are available. So a typical system might collect all of this data from all of the taxis in a city and then map users to it as the user dynamically arrives with requests. But in practice, we only need systems to store little bits of information. Because once this taxi comes to this point and becomes available again, that historic information is no longer needed. So we can forget about it, we can throw it away, and we just look at the new status of the taxi. And then if we look at that, then in this low latency architecture, we're centralizing the decision making into the cloud effectively. So all the data gets gathered into one place. But what we would very much like to do is make use of the computational power at the edge, where we are then looking at autonomy of devices. So each what we call a smart object or smart device can make its own decision. So it has some agency. It can interact with other objects in its vicinity to make good decisions on which services it wants to offer and when it wants to offer them, with a view of maintaining an overall kind of agreed best service capacity across the whole device or smart object ecosystem. And to do that, a lot of data needs to be gathered and processed on the devices, but that data tends to be relatively simple and most of the processing can be done on the device. And if things do really get very, very complicated, well, the device can always connect to the cloud for those decisions and seek insights from there. The final aspect that I want to look at is looking at data in new ways. So I mentioned earlier on that data obviously exists as the kind of values that we have, but data can also exist as links. And one of the questions that arose and where we worked on with an SME is in the area of linked or semantic data, where we were looking for financial fraud. So people in HMRC and so on obviously gather all the company records at the end of the year, and they tend to be looking a bit like this. So a bit like either a spreadsheet or a Word document or some other data structure that contains all of the information. But what it doesn't contain is the links between the various elements. So you could be director on seven different companies, and you would simply occur on seven different sheets, and no one would necessarily make the connections unless you know you're looking for a specific person and you go and start exploring. So what we have enabled is to automatically gather many of these sheets, process them into a semantic data structure where you then can start exploring. So you can look at who is the owner of a business, where do they live, who else lives with them, and so on, to then see whether there are any suspicious links between various companies. And then obviously fraud investigators can work in a much more directed and determined way. Okay. I think that sort of brings me to the end of the journey for today. So clearly much of my work has been done in areas of computer science. Beyond my work, many other computer scientists are working. They're working with experts from all sorts of other areas. And a lot of work has already been done. But I think if we are starting to look at those new applications, we also have many open questions that we need to answer. My work in particular contributes to scalable software architectures for data processing, semantic web applications for data exploration, service selection and composition, and all of this with a user and application focused view. And I think if we are starting to look at the next steps forward, then I think there's great opportunity in looking at combining already existing ideas to address some of the problems we are facing, because we already have so many solutions. They're just often existing in isolation. But then obviously we need to look at developing and researching the bits that improve on this state of the art, that give us the solutions to the places that we don't know, or that give us better solutions to some of the techniques we currently have. And all of that needs to be seen in kind of a much, much bigger system in some sense, in that context of the applications. I think key challenges we need to address are around ensuring data quality. And I don't think we have a lot of fantastic work so far that kind of gives us those guarantees around data quality. I think we do need to look much more at pushing AI and machine learning to the source of the data. And at the moment, many of the techniques are, and especially in recent years where the focus has been on deep learning, are not necessarily quite so flexible to be pushed out to small devices. And I think we have to learn to do something about that continuing growth of data. Because if we do want fast responses, if we do want to keep our bandwidth and storage use down, then we do need to start to learn to throw some of our data away and just say, well, thank you, we don't need this. So let me conclude by thanking you, and that you is many, many people. It's all my collaborators, colleagues, and PhD students over many years. Some names are on the slide, and I did a recent search on DBLP, which is the computer science paper repository, and it shows 115 co-authors. So I would have run out of space on the slide if I had listed all of them. So thank you very much to all that work with my collaborators and colleagues and PhD students. It's always exciting working with people from all around the world, and it's something I wouldn't want to miss, and it's to a large extent due to them to put me into the position that I am today. Also thanks to my family, who at times had to do without me for weeks and months on end when I was at research project visits and research visits abroad. And I know that that obviously is very hard on them. I had the good luck of being funded by various organizations over the years, and they enabled some of the work that was done. And thank you to the audience today. So all of you colleagues and guests for joining today and for listening. Thank you very much.